welcome you all in this session. As you are aware, in previous session we were discussing about hypothesis testing, and we have seen that there are different steps in hypothesis testing. We did work out couple of examples. Let us look at one more example on hypothesis testing. But before I take the next example, let me tell you what exactly we did in previous session. So, we tested null and alternative hypothesis. In fact, we framed null hypothesis and alternative hypothesis. Then we calculated z value, and for a given alpha value we found critical value from table, right? And then we compared the calculated z value with lower and upper limits of critical table values, right? And then finally we decided whether our hypothesis was rejected or not rejected. So, in previous case or in any case, you should reject a null hypothesis when the calculated z value is in rejection region. Reject it, otherwise do not reject it, right? Now, this is an example which we worked out in previous session as well. Now, here you have not been given an alpha value, right? Okay. So, what you did, you just calculated z value first, then population mean, right? Population mean plus minus whatever is z value, z calculated value, right? Not table value, right? Because we have not been given alpha, so we cannot have critical table value. So, use this z value over here, which is 2, and standard error, right? So, you will get these two limits, and your sample mean is this, which is not in this acceptance region, which is just over here, right? Just on the upper limit. So, we will reject null hypothesis, okay? In fact, then how did you get this when alpha was not given? So, what you did actually, after looking at this z value, the probability value from the z table is this, okay? So, this is how you can have a distribution like this, okay? But just for, if you want to, let us say, test a null hypothesis or alternative hypothesis, then without having significance level, you can get the answer, okay? Let us look at one more example. Let us say the strength of the axle is 80,000 pounds per square inch, and standard deviation is 4,000. When you take a sample of 100 axles, then sample mean is 79,600 pounds per square inch, right? Significance level is given. So, of course, z value would be 1.96, isn't it? Calculate z value, isn't it? So, this would be minus 1, right? Now, you just compare this minus 1 with this upper and lower limits, and you will see that this z calculated is in acceptance region. So, we will not reject the null hypothesis. So, we will not reject null hypothesis, and we will not reject null hypothesis. It means the axle strength is 80,000 pounds per square inch, right? Let us look at one more example. In fact, in this example itself, you can see this part carefully. So, this is standard error of mean, which is 400. Now, population mean plus minus 400 into this is table critical value, right? Or z value from table, right? Z value from table, isn't it? In previous example, we were not given alpha. So, what we did? We just used the value of z which we calculated, right? Now, you can get upper and lower limits here. So, upper limit is this, lower limit is this, and your sample mean is here. So, you can say that since sample mean is in this limit, you will not reject null hypothesis, right? So, there are two ways in which you can make a decision whether you are rejecting null hypothesis or you are not rejecting null hypothesis, right? One is on the basis of z value, compare z value with critical table values, and one is frame this interval, just formulate this interval and check whether sample mean is in between these two or not, right? Let us look at one more example. Let us say you have to give some dose to the patient, and if excess dose is given, it is not harmful to the patient, but if less quantity is given, then it would not produce sufficient result, right? So, how would you frame null and alternative hypothesis? This is how you can prepare null and alternative hypothesis, right? So, after this, you just calculate standard error first, which is this, and lower and upper limits. Similarly, z is minus 0.88, right? So, since this is just one tail test, you will have just one z value, right? Okay. In fact, you will have just one table critical value, right? And you just compare these two. Now, the calculated z value is in non-rejection region. So, you will not reject the null hypothesis. You will not reject the null hypothesis. And the other way of doing this is find out upper and lower limits and see whether the sample mean is in between these two. Yes, this is your sample mean. So, you will not reject null hypothesis, right? Let us look at, in fact, since this is a one tailed test and alpha is equal to 0.10. So, from this area, 50% area, we are interested in at this value, right? So, 50 minus 10, right? So, which is 0.4. So, look at the table, z table, where area is 0.4. So, that area would be at 1.28, right? So, 1.2 and 8 is here, right? So, this is 0.40, right? Let us look at one more example. Hinton Press hypothesizes that the average life of its largest web press is 14,500 hours. They know that the standard deviation of press life is 2001 hours. From a sample of 25 presses, the company finds a sample mean of 13,000 hours. It 0.01 significance level, should the company conclude that the average life of the press is less than hypothesized 14,500 hours? So, question is very simple. In fact, you need not, you know, focus much on framing null and alternative hypothesis, because hint is there in question itself. So, what is null hypothesis? Null hypothesis is that the average life of the press is 14,500 hours, isn't it? And alternative hypothesis is it is less than 14,500 hours, right? So, this is how you can frame null and alternative hypothesis, right? So, you have been given n as 25. So this is a clear cut case of one sample, one tail test, right? And one tail is what? It's an upper tail or lower tail test? It's a case of lower tail test, right? So just calculate z value, which is sample mean minus population mean divided by standard error of mean, right, which is minus 3.57. So how would you draw distribution of this problem, right? So this is a less than type of, so this is your rejection region, right, rejection region, and this is your mean, right, hypothesized mean. So the calculated z value is this, minus 3.57, okay. Now the table value is minus 2.33. So when you look at table value, how to find out table value? This area is 0.50, this area is 0.50, right? So this 0.50 minus 0.01, right? It's 0.49, isn't it? Now look at the z value when area is 0.49. Let's look at this 0.49. This here, right? So table value is this. So we should reject null hypothesis. The average life of the average life is significantly less than hypothesized value, okay. Now let's move on to next question. Let us solve a question using p-value approach. So so far we have solved our questions by comparing z value with the critical value, or by seeing whether the sample mean is falling within upper and lower limits or not, right. Let us look at another approach for testing hypothesis. It's called p-value approach. P-value is nothing but probability of obtaining test statistic equal to or more extreme than the observed sample value given null hypothesis is true, right? So it's basically a probability. P stands for probability, right? Probability of obtaining test statistics equal to observed sample value given null hypothesis is true. So it's also called observed level of significance. So you will in every question, in most of the questions you will have significance level given, right? And this is p value is nothing but observed level of significance. So we will compare observed level of significance and given significance level. So it is basically the smallest value for which H naught can be rejected, right, or null hypothesis can be rejected. The p-value approach for testing null hypothesis is this. So we always compare p-value and alpha value. If p is less than alpha, reject the null hypothesis, otherwise do not reject the null hypothesis. So just keep one point in mind in p-value approach, that if p is less than alpha, reject null hypothesis, otherwise not, right. So remember, if p is less than alpha, is less than significance level, H naught must go, right, or null hypothesis rejected, right. So these are a couple of steps in p-value approach, almost similar steps which we have seen in other approach. So first is state null and alternative hypothesis, choose significance level and sample size, Third is determine appropriate test statistics, right? Whether you want to use Z or T statistics, right? Collect data and compute the value of test statistic. Only the point here is what we are missing. In fact, earlier approach, there were 6 steps, right? So, one of the steps which we do not have in this approach is that we do not look at critical table values, right? So, that is why there are now 5 steps instead of 6 steps. So, finally, you have to make a decision, right? If p value is less than alpha, reject null hypothesis, otherwise not, and then managerial conclusion, right? So, let us look at the same question which we have solved earlier. So, we want to test a hypothesis that the number of TV sets in Indian homes is equal to 3, right? So, this is our null hypothesis, this is your alternative hypothesis, right? Since this is not equal to 3, so this is a case of two-tailed test, right? So, this is first step, second step, specify significance level which is given alpha and n, and for this alpha what is critical value 1.96, right? So, we would be using of course Z test because sample size is this, right, 100. And we have also been given standard deviation of population. So, that is why we will use Z test, right? Collect data and calculate Z statistics. So, which is -2, the same which we were getting in earlier approach, right? So, Z is -2. Now, till this point, the earlier approach and this approach are same, right? Now, calculate something called p value, right? Now, this is Z is 2, right? Okay. Now, what is the probability when Z is 2 in Z table, right? Let us look at. So, Z is equal to 2 and the probability under curve is this, right? So, let us say this is 0, this is 2 and this area is 0.4772, right? So, we are interested in, let us look at this, we are interested in this area, right? Isn't it? So, this area is, this side is 0.5, this side is 0.5 and we are interested in this area, right? So, from table we have got 0.4772 when Z was 2, right? Okay. So, probability Z less than 2 is 0.0228 and similarly this side same value, right, 0.0228. So, just add these two values. So, probability of Z between +2 and -2 is 0.0456, right. And you have to compare, and this is known as p value, right? You just compare this with alpha value. What was your alpha value? 0.05. So, is p value less than alpha? Yes, p value is less than alpha. So, we will reject the null hypothesis, right? Since p value is less than alpha, so we will reject null hypothesis. And what was our null hypothesis? That the average number of TV sets in Indian homes is equal to 3, right? So, there is a sufficient evidence to conclude that the number of TV sets in Indian homes is not equal to 3. Again, when I say not equal to 3 means either more than 3 or less than 3. So, what it is? It is more than 3 or less than 3? It is less than 3 because our sample mean is less than 3, right? Now, there is a relationship between two-tailed test and confidence interval. In fact, this is another approach of testing hypothesis. In fact, we have seen couple of methods earlier, and apart from p-value approach, this is another way of testing a hypothesis. So, just find out confidence interval. So, confidence interval is mean plus minus z, right, into standard error, isn't it? And see whether population mean falls in this range or not. In fact, we have seen one method wherein we wrote mu plus minus z this, isn't it? When alpha was given, we used table value. When alpha was not given, we used calculated z value, okay. And we checked whether sample mean was in this range or not. Here we are doing similar to that, but we are finding confidence interval and we are checking is population mean falls in this range. So, let us find out this range or confidence interval, which is 2.68 to 2.99, right. Do you have your hypothesized mean in this range? No. So, we will reject the null hypothesis, okay. So, we have seen how many methods. First, when you were given alpha, second, when you were not given alpha, but you used z value. In third case, the third one was p approach, the fourth one is this confidence interval approach, right. So, we have seen four methods to decide or to test hypothesis testing, right. Let us look at next slide. Now, in real life, we really do not know standard deviation of population. In fact, in case of sampling and sample distribution, when we studied that topic, we have seen that in reality, we really do not know the population standard deviation or population proportion. Similarly, in hypothesis testing as well, you will have a situation where standard deviation of population is unknown. So, we really do not know standard deviation of population. So, what do we do in, what we did in fact earlier, we used sample standard deviation to represent population standard deviation, right. So, same thing we will do here as well, right. So, as I said, you really do not know the population standard deviation, because if you know the population standard deviation, then you also know mean, right, population mean, because to know, because to calculate, you need mu, right. Since to calculate standard deviation, you need population mean. Since we do not know this, we really do not know this. But let us say if we know this, then we also know this, right. And if we know this, then what, why are we doing this exercise? Because in this exercise, we are trying to know about population mean from sample, right. So, in real life, we really do not know standard deviation of population. So, we'll replace standard deviation of sample for standard deviation of population. Now, what changes you should do when standard deviation is unknown? So, first is, instead of z test, we will use t test, right. And even in this situation when standard deviation is unknown, we assume that the population is normally distributed. Your sampling follows normal distribution. In fact, this is what, this CLT, right, central limit theorem, right, okay. And all other steps will remain same. Only the change would be what, instead of z test, we would be using t test, right. So, this is how you should be calculating t statistics. It is very similar to what we calculated when we knew this, okay. So, it was standard deviation earlier, now here it is sample standard deviation, right. Earlier it was population standard deviation, right. So, let us look at an example. The average cost of hotel room in New Delhi is said to be 168 rupees per night. To determine if this is true, a random sample of 25 hotels is taken, which resulted in an average of 172.5 rupees. And sample standard deviation 15.4. Test the appropriate hypothesis at significance level alpha, which is this. Now, the question is, what is the null and alternative hypothesis? So, our null hypothesis is this. We have said that the population mean is 168 and the other one is, it's not 168. So, it's a case of one tail test or two tail. So, this is not equal to, right. So, this is a case of one tail test or two tail test. This is a case of two tail test, right, because this symbol is not equal to type, right. So, you will have two rejection regions, right. Okay. Let us look at this. So, we have already seen this is 168 and this is not equal to 168, right. Now, how to proceed further? Calculate t statistics, right, x minus mu, right, 172.5 minus 168 divided by s under root of n. Let us calculate that value, right. So, that value is 1.46, okay. Now, we have been given alpha is equal to 0.05, right. So, alpha by 2 is 0.025. Degrees of freedom, since n is 25, at 24 degrees of freedom, we have to see the critical value, okay. So, at 0.025 at 24 degrees of freedom, let us see what's t value. At 24 degrees of freedom and 0.025, this is 0.025 right here, this one. In fact, this is 0.975. So, 1 minus this is 0.025, right, and 24 degrees of freedom is this. This is 2.0687. So, where is that value? This 2.0693. This is the one, 2.06, yeah, right, 2.0639, right, which is here, right. Okay. So, what is the conclusion now? You have calculated, in fact, t value and critical value from table. So, compare this calculated t value with table value. So, we will say that this calculated t value falls in this region, right, in non-rejection region. So, your decision is you do not reject the null hypothesis, right. Do not reject null hypothesis. It means the average price of hotel in Delhi is 168 rupees, right. So, there is insufficient evidence that the true mean cost or the true price of hotel in Delhi is this much, 168, right. So, we will say it is 168, it is not more than this, or it is not. Let's see whether it is more than this or less than this, right? Yeah. In fact, we have not rejected it, right? So we'll say that the mean price is this much, right? Had we rejected it, then we would have said that the mean price has gone up because our average is 172.5, right? But we are saying that we'll not reject null hypothesis and the price is 168 rupees, right? Let us look at same example. You can in fact solve using different tools, right? Either you use, let's say, SPSS software or Minitab software, or let's say if you are using Excel sheet, or let's say if you are using SAS software or any other software for that matter, right? So the same example can be solved using Excel sheet, right? You only the point is you need to, let's say you just enter data in one of the columns as, let's say, 168 is the null hypothesis, significance level is 0.05, sample size 25, sample mean is this, sample standard deviation. You just apply the formula for sample standard, right? Sample standard deviation, then standard error of mean, this is, let's say, B8 square root of B6, then you will degrees of freedom, of course, sample size minus 1, right? So this is, let's say, this is B6, right? This cell is B6, right? So similarly, you can have B6 minus 1. Test statistics is B7 minus B4 divided by B11, right? And then upper and lower limits, right? And if you apply this particular, let's say, formula, you will get p value. And finally, since this is a case wherein we are using p value. So is p value less than alpha? No. P value is more than alpha, so we will not reject null hypothesis, right? Okay. So this is how you should solve a question on using t-test, right? When sample standard deviation is being used for population standard deviation. Thank you.